and they preached into the house this morning. And when we read in the book of John, when we meet Nathanael by the fig tree, we find when he approaches Jesus Christ, we find Jesus says, "Behold an Israelite in whom there is no guile." And Nathanael says, "How do you even know of me?" Amen. I'm glad we serve a God that even before he came to the sanctuary this morning, he already knew your situation. And he already knew your circumstance and where you were. He saw each and every single one of us under the fig tree. He said, "I know who you are before you even approach me." There is no mistake about you being in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. You serve a God who not only sees, but who can do something about your situation. Amen. A God who not only sees, but who is able to work in your life and in your family. To begin to worship, magnify a God and whom there is nothing hid from him. He's still the same God yesterday, today, and forever. He's still a healer. He's still a deliverer. He's still the Almighty God, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. His blood still works in our lives this morning. If there be any need this morning, oh hallelujah, if there's any situation, any issue, let's bring before our God this morning. Father, we worship you. We magnify you. God, we know you're able to work in my life. I give you everything this morning. Oh, hallelujah. Let your spirit move, God, from the pulpit to the pews. Let a miracle happen in this place. Oh, let your Shekinah glory, let it move all over the pews today. Oh, God, you're still able. Magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Let's praise him, church.
We worship you, Jesus. We worship you because of who you are, God. We worship you because you sit high, God, but you look low. We worship you, Jesus. It's because of who you are.
Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise.
It's because of who you
because
are.
Because of who you are,
I will lift my voice.
I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are.
It's because of who you are. to worship him, just to say thank you for being God, for resting in this house, for meeting me here, Jesus, just to say thank you because you're a God who is faithful. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Heaven, to open up in your family. Ask come through this house. Open up the heavens, pour your spirit out. Like a mighty wind, blow through this house. Open up the heavens, pour your spirit out. Like a raging fire, burn in my soul. Baptize me with the Holy Ghost.
Give him a high praise. And suddenly there was a sound. I said, and suddenly there was a sound of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of a fire, and they were all filled. Come on, they were all filled. You ought to come to church on a Sunday morning. Say, rain, Lord. Anybody want the rain on a Sunday morning? Hallelujah, hallelujah. I want the fire of the Holy Ghost. Oh, glory be to his name. God bless you. You may be seated in this atmosphere. All of our guests and friends, if you have children and you are looking around and wondering why there seems to be an absence of children, young people, our Sunday school on Sunday mornings, due to what God is doing, they are staying down in all the Sunday school rooms. See an usher, a greeter. They'll get your kids and your teens to the classes that are going on right this moment. How many is thankful for all of our Sunday school teachers and the great staff that labor on Sunday morning? Amen. They do not get to sit in service with us, but they are teaching the engrafted word of God into our children and next generation. And for that, I'm very thankful. It is so good to have the entire Harris family, the Veda family. Let's give them a great big welcome. Bienvenidos a casa de Dios. Hallelujah. Big welcome. Big welcome. We love them. Looking forward to hearing the word of God and dedicating little Junior this morning. And I got to thinking about the first time I met little Junior's daddy. And boy, I got a strong burden of prayer that come upon me. And so today we are going to, the Bible says that children are like arrows in the hands of a mighty archer. That means that parents have great power in the direction and the future of their children. And what we are going to do today at the end of the preached word of God is not bring salvation to this child. There will come a day very soon where he will speak in other tongues as the Spirit of God gives the utterance according to Acts chapter 2, fulfilling John 3 and 3 and 3 and 5. And he will be baptized in the only saving name, the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of it. Hey, if you haven't been baptized today, it's a good day to get baptized in Jesus' name. For there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And so we're excited about what God is going to do, but so glad this entire family is here connected to what God is doing at Hilltop. The ushers are coming right now to serve us this Sunday morning. Amen. Also, all the guests, there's guests and friends all over the house, friends and family. I'm glad there's no enemies in the house of the Lord. What does that mean? The devil was too scared to come to Hilltop on a Sunday morning, because the prayer room was doing what the prayer room. Come on, somebody. I believe that no weapon formed against the church is going to prosper. And I feel perfect liberty and anointing in this house today. Let's remember, tomorrow night is family night right here on the church grounds. You don't want to miss it. There will be burgers, hamburgers. I believe in Mexican food and bacon cheeseburgers. That's what I believe in right there. When you get outside of the Word of God, Because you can, I've never seen somebody sad eating a bacon cheeseburger and or eating ice cream. But there's going to be chips and sodas. And so we're going to work out and we're going to burn some calories. And then we're going to replace those calories. Because in Pentecost, we're into maintaining things. Hallelujah. So I can't tell you you're going to lose weight, but we're going to have a great time. Don't miss it. This will be going concurrently through the summer. Stay tuned. We have some special events planned within these Monday nights. And everybody said amen. How many is excited about what God is doing in your life? How many's got too many blessings? Let me see your hand. You got too many blessings. All right, let me rephrase that. How many doesn't want another blessing? Okay, praise God. If you need a blessing in your life and your family, I want you to stand with me in this house. We're going to give as unto the Lord. We march from the back to the front, and we give cheerfully unto the Lord of our tithe, which is our obedience. But then there's a most unique opportunity that a lot of people forget, is that our offering is love. Obedience is beautiful. But I'm glad that I don't just have an obedient wife and I have one, but that she operates out of love. You can taste it in the food. You can feel it in the hug. Come on, somebody. Anybody awake on a Sunday morning? The Bible says he loves a cheerful giver. I believe it like this. He loves when we come loving on him, saying, God, I'm not just being obedient today. I want you to know how much I love you. I love you with all of my heart and with all of my increase and with all of my future, for that's what the offering does. Let's give as unto the Lord today. Help me pray. Lord, your word is so true. It's implicit in every detail that you cannot be outgiven. I've never met anybody that's ever outgiven you. Lord, I like to live by this white ways. I can't afford not to be blessed by you. You truly are a God of abundance. You press it down. You shake it together. And Lord, it runs over. I pray today, bless every home, bless every marriage, bless our children. God, I pray help this country. And God, please fix what's going on at the gas pump. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Somebody said amen. Let's march. Let's give. After you've given, shake somebody's hand. They're going to play. They're going to worship. Let's give as unto the Lord.
Fill me,
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, lift up your voice like a hungry vessel. Fill me up, God, to overflowing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Pour of your spirit into my vessel. Fill me up. Somebody said in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. You may be seated. So thankful that Brother Harris, Senior Pastor Harris, Bishop Harris, he has many titles, but the greatest one is that he's a preacher of truth. He is a man that walks in the word. We want him to come. Elder, we love you. Always glad you're no stranger to this pulpit. Testify.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Don't just say it. Let's do it. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. He is worthy to receive praise. Amen. Amen. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord today. We certainly give honor to Bishop and Lady Buxton and First Lady and Pastor Joel Buxton. We thank you all. Love you all. And what an incredible church. It's good to be back home this morning. And I believe this is a transformative service. I believe that every service we come to is transformative. Amen. When the preaching of the word goes forth, faith comes by hearing. And if you listen to the wrong stuff, you'll get faith in the wrong stuff. But when you hear the preaching of the word, it transforms our lives. Amen. And we come to a house today where we can turn our problems into praise. We can turn our worries and our whys into worship. And we can magnify the Lord in this house today. Amen. It's good to be here with you. Looking forward to the move of the Spirit.
Oh, we ought to give God a great big hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. I like that. Turn your worry into worship. Amen, amen, amen. So thankful for the years that are going by very fast. I will quickly say this before my father and our bishop comes to preach today, and I'm looking forward to the word of the Lord, is that you never know what's going to happen when you walk into a house where truth is proclaimed. And I look back through the years, Brother Harris, I remember sitting in a different drum cage, and you walk down that aisle like only a PK can walk down the aisle in all of our optics of Pentecost and who and what and the tribes. And I watched them walk in. I had no idea what God was going to do in their life. I didn't really know. In fact, we were fixing to hop into a trailer and leave evangelizing. But I want to say this today, that it is incredible to watch the handiwork of God, not just in the heavens, not just in his majestic ways throughout creation, but how God would bring together Brother Nathan Harris and Sister Brianna. I remember her as a much younger lady, and you had no clue. And now to watch them, years are going by as God has propelled their ministry all across Pentecost. And it's because of a man of God that was in the pulpit that took a risk on a young man. Why don't we stand in honor of the man of God, the word of God that he bears. We want our bishop to come and preach today. Preach it.
Let's give that unto the Lord because he's worthy. Help me praise him, would you? Oh, let's love the Lord. Let's love him together. Hallelujah. Very special Sunday morning as Hilltop family joins with the Harris family. And we return back to God what God has blessed them with. I will be preaching today with them in mind, but I'm preaching to everybody that's here. So please don't shut off your ears. This is for you. And we will be concentrating in just a little bit about little Nathaniel Harris III, and the second, and the third's on its way, maybe. Who knows? I don't know. And y'all said you wanted kids. You getting them. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter number 11. And I would begin in verse number 6. Hebrews 11 and 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe, number one, that he is. Number two, that is rewarder of them that diligently seek him. By faith, Noah. Everybody say Noah. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. For the next few moments, I just want to preach how to save your house. How to save your house. How many wants to save their house today? Come on, you really want to save your house. Everything in your house. Everything that comes into your house. Lift that other hand. Let's ask God's anointing. Savior, we love you. I pray that your anointing would rest upon us. Move among us here today. I pray that you would anoint my heart, my mind, my lips of clay. Allow the Spirit of God to have free course. I prayed in the name of Jesus. And everybody said amen. Now would you give the Lord a hand praise?
Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You may be seated. God bless you. Hebrews 11 is a chapter that is preached from a whole lot. In the book of Hebrews 11, we find a very commonly woven thread that runs from generation to generation. It runs from family through family. It runs from covenant to covenant. But the commonality in all of that is this word called faith, this heartbeat, this decision, this attitude of life. You would find, and I read to you in verse number 6, that without faith it's impossible to please God. So I would submit to you today that in order for us to be saved, we are going to have faith, because I don't see us being saved displeasing God. I see that it is a very, very intricate part of our salvation. But when I read the story of Noah mentioned here in verse number 7, I realize that the writer of Hebrews allowed us to recognize that there are some very important components about faith. That faith is not just an attitude. Faith is not just a word. Faith is not just a reaction. But I'm going to show you through the word of the Lord that faith wears a tool belt. And faith makes preparation. And faith goes out into a world and conquers what is needed to make sure that I am going to save my house. I believe that in preaching about Noah, that all of us could understand first and foremost that Noah recognized by God that he was living in a very dangerous world. In fact, the scripture teaches us that the commandment or the judgment of God was hanging heavy upon the earth, and Noah knew it. Noah realized that the judgment of God was coming. Noah realized that the impending danger of God was upon them.
Noah understood also that the judgment of God was coming in a way that had never come upon the earth before. So there was nothing to draw from. There was no pattern to look at. It required absolute dependence upon the Word of God. And so I would submit to you this morning that the first thing that Noah had to deal with is there is danger upon my family. There is danger that surrounds us. There is danger that bookends everything that I am going to do. The danger was a deadly flood that was coming. We all know the dangers of a flood. Can I preach a few moments here? We all understand that the danger of the flood is not just the fact of whether you can swim or not. But a flood does more than just drown people. Floods alter landscape. Floods redirect the way that rivers run. Floods reshape the land that's around you. You may be able to swim and survive the rising of the water, but I want to tell you, floods can cut you off from life. Floods can isolate you. Floods can put you on islands by yourself. Floods can, if you survive the flood, it can destroy everything around you. Floods have the ability of bringing snakes and serpents upon what land is remaining. Floods will move you out of your comfort zones. Floods will push you away from places that are comfortable. I want to talk about it right now. If it doesn't kill you, it can destroy everything you've ever gathered. If it doesn't kill you, it can destroy everything you put together. If it doesn't kill you, it can destroy the stuff that you have gathered. I want to preach to you today, it's not fun to go through a flood. An entire lifetime of work and savings can disappear in just an afternoon of rain. Everything that a person's worked for, it can go down the drain literally. If you know that the flood is coming, I'm going to preach to you this morning. If you're going to learn how to save your house, you're going to have to understand whether the rain is falling now or not, whether the water is raining or water is rising now or not, whether the rivers are altering their course now or not. I've got to be a wise man and understand that I've heard a word from God, and God said, I'm bringing judgment. It's going to come. I want to preach to you, Daddy. You've got to look past your neighbors. You've got to look past your neighborhood. You've got to look past common knowledge. You've got to look past popular opinion and understand the judgment's coming from God. And the only way to deal with it is I got to find out the way that God says to deal with this danger. Noah's preaching that it's going to rain. Read your Bible. It hadn't rained in 2,000 years. I want to talk to you how to save your house. You're going to be laughed at. You're going to be mocked at. You're going to be misunderstood. People are going to look at you narrowly. People are going to do their best to try and twist you. I want to talk to somebody right now. But you better understand what I'm going to preach today. There's a storm in everybody's life. There's a storm in everybody's horizon. And if you're going to save your house, you're going to have faith in your spirit that I'm going to do what God's called me to do. I'm going to build my life like God called me to build it. I'm going to make sure my feet's on a rock. Because whether I know it or not, the storm is on its way. The day in which we live today, it's not enough to build spiritual dams about our lives. We think that we've seen it already, and we can withstand the storm of the year, or the storm of the decade, or the storm of the century,
or the storm of the millennium. But I'm going to preach to somebody here today. You're not going to be able to withstand the greatest storm that's headed your way if you think you can do it without the help of God. Let me preach to every dad that's in this house. You better learn how to build an altar. You better learn how to pray out loud. You better learn how to dedicate your family into the hands of God and say, I cannot wait until the storm starts raging, and I can't wait till the water starts falling. I've got to build an ark in the good times. I've got to build an ark in the blue sky. I've got to build the ark when the wind's not blowing. Because if I'm going to save my family, I've got to build an ark. Can I submit to you this morning that we are living in the age when the Bible says that everything that can be shaken will be shaken? Daniel chapter 12, verse 1. And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book. Thank God that this scripture teaches of deliverance. But I want to preach to you, before there's deliverance, there's going to be a dilemma. Before there's deliverance, there's going to be a storm. Before there's deliverance, the water's going to fall. I'm going to preach to somebody right now. The flood that we're going to be tested with, the flood that's on its way, it's going to test your morals. It's going to test your stamina. It's going to test your faith. It's going to test your character. It's going to test your word. It's going to test your name. And I want to preach to you, if you're going to save your family, you got to learn how to build a dam against the world that's going to try and destroy you. Hallelujah. There's a danger, but thank God there's a dad. I don't want to preach about the danger any longer, but I thank God there's a dad. America this year has just become the most dadless nation in first world countries. We have an epidemic upon us of drastic proportions that dads are an absent factor in our homes. The reason that society is crumbling and the reason that our inner cities are being destroyed, it's not because of drugs, it's not because of alcohol, it's not because of prostitution, it's not because of firearms, but the missing component is a dad that will stand in the middle of danger and say, I'm going to build an ark and save my family. Can I preach to somebody right now? Thank God for a daddy that's going to stand between them and the flood. Thank God for a dad that says, I'm not just going to preach it. I'm going to put a tool belt on. I'm going to get a hammer. I'm going to get a saw. I'm going to get to the woods. I'm going to cut down a tree, and I'm going to build an ark to the saving of my house. How do you save your house? I'm glad you asked me, Daddy. You got to save it by faith. You got to worship when you don't feel like it. You got to go to church when you don't feel like it. You got to show up when you're not singing. You got to show up when you're not preaching. Let me preach a little while right now. How do you save your family? You save your house by saying, today, if I don't do nothing else but cut a tree down, I'm cutting a tree down. I'm going to sweat while others party. I'm going to work while others slumber. Why? Because I'm saving my house.
Can I preach it? You're going to save your house by building an ark. You're going to build something your neighbor's not building. You're going to build something the neighborhood's not building. You're going to build something you've never built before. You're going to build something you've never seen before. You're going to say, I got to save my house, but I can't save my house by building a house. I'm going to save my house by building an ark. I got to build a place of salvation. I got to build a place of safety. You don't save your house by 401ks. Because one flood. One flood. Read about the Depression in 29. Read about early American history where people were multimillionaires one morning, and the next morning they woke up and they jumped out of windows and committed suicide because all of their fortunes were gone. I want to talk to you, Daddy. I want to talk to you. Your kid doesn't need you to work overtime near as much as he needs you to pray overtime. You want to give your child something new. Give him a new consecration. Give him new dedication. Give him a new understanding of the commitment of the kingdom. Give him fresh revelation. I'm preaching right now. How do you save your house? You save your house by not worrying about your neighbors. You save your house by not worrying about social media. You save your house not worrying about what others are saying. Can I preach it right now? Noah saved his house by protecting his family with his faith. Noah said, by faith. The book of Hebrews says it. By faith, Noah built an ark to the saving of his house. I'm going to preach to Daddy right now. You want to protect your house. You want to save your house. Protect it with your faith. Protect it with your worship. Protect it with your singing. Protect it with your service. Protect it with your sacrifice. Noah protected his family. Noah saved his house with spiritual hearing. He listened to the Spirit. He opened his heart to the Spirit. He opened his mind to the Spirit. Let me preach to you right now. You want to save your house? Turn your ear on to the Holy Ghost. Turn your ear up to the still, small voice and save your house. Noah saved his house by protecting his family with fear. Let's talk about it for a little bit. Talk about society today. Dogpile society. Let's talk about it. Noah stood by himself. I'm going to preach to daddies a few more moments. You're not always going to have people agree with you. In fact, the vast majority of the time, they're going to disagree with you. They're going to look at you strange. They're going to look at you narrowly. They're going to mock you. They're going to question you. They're going to talk about you. Let me preach for a few moments. They're going to look at you sideways, out of the side of their head. They're going to look at you. You're disconnected. You're out of control. But I want to talk to you. If you keep on building, Daddy, if you keep building when you're by yourself, if you keep building when you're traveling alone, if you keep building, I'm going to cut a tree down today. I'm going to sharpen my tools today. I'm going to put my tool belt on today. Nobody helped him. Nobody helped him. They laughed at him. They mocked him. They questioned him. But I'm going to preach to you. When the first drop of rain started falling, that foolish old daddy became the wisest daddy that had ever lived. That foolish old man became the wisest man that had ever lived. Why? It's because you better not judge a dad when you got blue sky. You judge a dad when water begins to fall. You judge a dad when calamity happens. And you're going to say, you know what? Maybe he wasn't crazy after all. Noah saved his house by protecting them with fear. We're going to fear God. We're going to keep his commandments. We're going to honor God.
we're going to give God his best. And then Noah protected his family with the building of an ark. I don't want to spend a bunch of time here, but I could. Ham, Shem, Japheth, and their wives didn't get in anybody else's ark. They didn't hitchhike. They didn't mooch off anybody. Noah said, if I'm going to save my family, I got to build my own ark. I got to build my own boat. I got to build my own home. I got to build my own family. I got to build my own relationship with God. I got to build my own consecration. I got to build my own commitment. Let me preach a little bit right here. Noah understood, if I'm the only one with hands in the air, my hands will be in the air. If I'm the only one with a mouth open, my mouth will be open. If I'm the only one singing, I'm going to be singing. If I'm the only one praying, I'm going to be praying. I'm going to preach to you. Thank God that there was a dad that stood in the way of the storm. Thank God there was a daddy that said, the rain's coming, the rain's coming, the wind's gonna blow and the waters are gonna rise, but God's given me the ability as a dad to say, I'm gonna stand between danger and destruction. I'm gonna stand between the oncoming onslaught and the judgment of God. God's not just given me a baby, but God's given me a soul. I've got to protect that soul by saving my house. Is it not amazing? Is it not amazing to you that you read in Hebrews 11 that by the building of an ark, Noah saved his house? Nothing ever mentioned about his house. Nothing ever mentioned about his four walls. Nothing ever mentioned about his driveway. Nothing ever mentioned about his front yard or his backyard. But when God looked at his children, he said, that's your house. I'm going to preach to you for a few moments. Anybody can build a structure, but it takes a man of God to build a house. You can put a hammer and nails against a wood and you can build four walls and a roof. But I want to preach to you right now. When God looked down at Noah, God said, Noah, you're going to save your house. You are saving it. What's your house called? What's the address of your house? My address is Ham, Shem, and Japheth. My address is my babies. My address is those that God gave to me. And if I'll be faithful, I'll save my house. How are you going to do it? By preparing an ark, by teaching them to pray, by teaching them to worship, by teaching them to do the will of God. You're saving your house. Can I preach to you? It's more important than an apartment. It's more important than a mansion. You got to have a household. How do you save your house? By saving your children. What have we accomplished if we gain the whole world and lose our children? Can I tell you they need godly heritage more than they need money? You going to help me for a few more moments? Can I tell you they're going to need memories in their spirit of moms and dads that were not throwing everything away trying to make another nickel, but they got moms and dads and memories of moms and dads that said, we don't have a whole lot right now, but we're going to get to the house of God. We're going to worship a God that supplies all of our... I'm preaching to you. How do you save your house? You save your house by burning yourself up in the Holy Ghost. You save your house by saying, I'm going to have an ark built around my household that when the storm comes. can protect your family in a lot of different ways. But the greatest hedge is to build faith in their life. Faith. Faith. By faith. You ready? Noah. Being warned of God of things not yet seen. He didn't see a cloud. Can I have a couple more moments? He didn't see dark clouds. He didn't hear boisterous winds. He didn't see rains. But he was moved by things not yet seen. But then the Bible says he was moved with fear. Can I preach right now? It's too late to start building when the rain's fallen. It's too late to start building an ark when your daughter says she's pregnant. It's too late to start building an altar when your son says he's in trouble. It's too late when can I preach to you right now? A wise daddy stands between the dilemma and the deliverance. A wise daddy, before he sees anything, before he hears anything, he just heard the word of God. And a wise daddy, being moved by fear, is going to build a house. He prepared an ark to the saving of his house. Quickly, Acts 16:31, and they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." You ready? And the house. The house. And the house. Not your structure. Not your address. Not your four walls, not your piece of property. You believe on the Lord and you're going to be saved and your house. When the rain comes, believe on the Lord. When dilemma comes, believe on the Lord. When the devil comes, believe on the Lord. When situations come, believe on the Lord, because your belief is preparing an ark to the saving of your How's Nathaniel II going to know how to do it unless his daddy shows him how to do it? Your daddy believes on the Lord, and in doing so, it's saving him, but it's also saving you. I'm not giving him over to Hollywood. I'm not turning him over to this and that and the other. I'm going to believe on God. What about when the doctor says this? I'm going to believe on the Lord. What about when education says this? I'm going to believe on the Lord. What about when society says this? I'm going to believe on the Lord. And in doing so, I'm going to save myself. But I'm also going to save my house. Why? Because the house knows what daddy does. Lydia, Acts 16, verse 14 to 15. Lydia and her whole house was saved. You know why? Because faith protects. And faith watches over us. And faith delivers us. And faith preserves us. Noah protected his family by faith. It wasn't just Noah standing out in front of the world being mocked. I want to talk about it right now. Thank God for praying mamas. That can I preach to daddies for a couple of moments? It wasn't Noah's mama that built the ark. It was Noah that built the ark. It wasn't Noah's mama that God talked to. It was Noah that God talked to. It wasn't Noah's mama that picked up the hammer. And thank God for what our wives do. But daddy had to realize, I've got to do this.
Can I preach to dads for a few more moments? Daddy, you need to pray for your kid's salvation. You need to claim your kids for the kingdom. Daddy, you got to protect them with your prayer. Daddy, you got to fight the devil in their lives by faith. Daddy, you got to set the example. Because the kids are going to do what daddy does. I'm not going to preach about Job, but Job chapter 1, the Bible says that Job offered sacrifices on behalf of his kids. Tell me how it worked out. It didn't. Can I talk to you, Daddy? I know it's quiet right now. This needs to be warm and fuzzy. It will be warm and fuzzy here in a minute. I just want dads to understand what they're doing. You're standing between the destruction of your house. You're standing between the dilemma that's on this society. Come on, you cannot put this off on somebody else. Your kids ain't going to be saved getting on somebody else's boat. They're not going to be delivered getting on somebody else's prayer. You got to build your own ark to the saving of your house. You want to save your house, build an ark. You want to save your house, pray. You want to save your house, worship. You want to save your house, sacrifice. You want to save your house, give. You want to save your house, model salvation. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. I said hallelujah. There was no outward evidence. When Noah was preaching, there was no outward evidence that what Noah believed would ever occur. I don't know why you're so twisted on all this, preacher. You're preaching all this stuff. I don't see this happening. Yeah. Same thing they said to Noah. It's never rained. Jesus is going to catch his bride out of here. That's never happened before. It's never been a rapture. You're just trying to use that to manipulate us and scare us. Really? Well, remember to go talk to Noah. Go talk to Noah's neighbors. Go talk to the world, because he sounded like an idiot until the first drop fell. He sounded like an idiot until the monkey started running. He sounded like an idiot until the giraffe started galloping. He sounded like an idiot until elephants start trumpeting. I'm preaching to you right now. You got to rise up, Daddy, and say, it doesn't matter what anybody else is saying. I'm going to save my family, but I'm saving my house by building an ark. Larry Norman, this isn't mine, but I quoted this. I copied and pasted this yesterday, a song. I wish we'd all been ready. Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold, a piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wished we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come and you've been left behind. A man and wife asleep in bed, she hears a noise and turns her head. He's gone. I wish we'd all been ready. Is it okay to preach about the coming of the Lord? Two men walking up a hill, one disappears, one's left standing still. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come and you're behind. How could you have been so blind? By faith, you gotta move with fear. The Father spoke, the demons dying. The sun has come and you've been left behind. Dad, I'm preaching in closing. Your fear is gonna protect your family. Your fear that God doesn't lie. Your fear that God doesn't stutter. How come you're so bent up about that? Because I gotta save my home. And the only way to save my house is to build an ark. Stand with me. Noah was moved by fear. There's nothing any more devastating to a dad than to think that his children are going to be lost.
There's nothing any more devastating to a dad than think that his children are going to come up short. I'm preaching to you, Dad. You know why we dedicate children to God. The rest of the world may not do this, but we're doing this. We want God to know I'm building an ark. A baby dedication is nothing more than building an ark. A baby dedication is nothing more than I am going to create a space in their life. I'm going to pitch it within, and I'm going to pitch it without. I'm going to make sure I put the right stuff on the inside, and I'm going to make sure I put the right stuff on the outside. I'm going to make sure that it's not just what I do on the outside, and I'm going to make sure it's not just what I do on the inside. I've got to protect them internally, and I got to protect them externally. Why? Because I am building an ark. When you build an ark, you save your house. Hallelujah. But Noah, by faith. For the Harris, there's going to be times that nobody understands you. There's going to be times that nobody's hearing you. There's going to be times that you look at your house. You look at your house. You look at your wife. You look at your children. You look at life. You look at your circumstances. And you know the only tack right now is faith. The only movement is faith. The only way to act is by faith. I can't trust my feelings. I can't trust what I see or don't see. I know I've heard from God, and I gotta move by faith. It's faith that causes you to get up in the middle of the night and lay your hand on their fevered brow. It's faith that causes you to look in the eyes of your wife and say, I don't know how God's going to do this, but I do know God's going to do it. You just got to trust me right now. It's faith. Faith is bringing them to church when everybody else isn't. Faith is saying, we're not running back to the ER. We're going to lay hands on this baby, and we're going to pray in the name of Jesus Christ. It's faith that says you're going to get back in that pew and you're going to lift your hands back in the air and you're going to talk to God. It's faith that when they're teenage years and they don't want to come to church, you're going to say it's no debate. We're not discussing it. Get dressed. We're going to the house of God. Why? I'm building an ark. Why? I'm saving my house. Your role, Brother Harris, is lifeguard. Your role is sitting on a tower when everything's safe. Your role is not playing when they're playing. Your role is not splashing when they're splashing. Your role is watching, preparing. The goal is not financial. The goal is not social. The goal is not educational. But the goal is spiritual. I gotta save them from the onslaught of the storm that's on its way. As a preacher of the gospel, you stir up demons of hell. As a preacher of the gospel, you stir up devils that other people don't stir up. As a preacher of the gospel, there are winds that are going to be accompanied by spirits that are going to do their best to blow into your house and to blow into your structure, because they know if I can't get to him, I can get to him through his kids. But I am preaching to you as a lifeguard in the daylight, when there's no storm, when there's no cloud. I'm building an ark because I want to save my house. God's already walked you through miracles. God's already laid his hand upon you. I remember the phone call that you gave me. Didn't know how it was going to happen, but it's happened. And it's not just one, but now we got twins. And this is shortly thereafter. You ain't going to believe this, but God smiled upon us again. And every devil that said it couldn't is still after you. And every devil that said it won't happen is still after you. And every devil that you've run away, it's still after you. But today, I'm building an ark. People aren't going to understand you. Oh, Harris is still preaching. Oh, why is he out there preaching? It's not rained. Why is he building a family that way? Because I'm not doing this for you. I'm doing this for me. I'm trying to save my house. And to save my house, I'm building an ark. By faith, Noah, being moved by things not yet seen, built an ark to the saving of his house. I wonder if the entire Harris family would come and stand in front of me. Both families, pardon me. Sister Brianna, one of the greatest things you can do for your children is to teach them how great a dad they've got. One of the greatest things that you can ever do for your children is to always hear them talk about, you got a good daddy, your daddy's protecting you, your daddy's fighting for you, your daddy's building an ark. Don't ever let them hear anything negative about their daddy. Because daddy's lifeguard. Daddy sits on a tower and sees things that other people will never see. There's going to be times, mama, when little twins are going to come out of their bedroom and daddy's going to say, go back in there and change. But why? They look cute. No, daddy's on the tower. I see stuff out there. There's going to be time. Little Nathaniel's going to, and daddy says, stop. Not in this house. Why? I see stuff out there in the horizon. So a miracle that God gave us, we're bringing it back to God. Saying, God, I don't just want to be thankful that you blessed us with three children. What good is it for me to have three babies and lose them? I want to build an ark. I want to build an ark so I can save my house. Pastor, would you come with me? Would you come grab this little man? Why are we doing what we're doing? Does this save him? No. Does this make his calling with God an election? Sure. No. Does this bypass the gospel? No. Why are you doing this? Because we're building an ark. Saying, you know how you're going to make it, Bubba? You're going to have to stay in the boat with mom and daddy. And when the rain comes, there's a place of safety. Would you stretch your hands toward this family when we pray, God? God, we bring him back to this altar. We bring him back, God. We're just trying to protect him. We're trying to make sure, God, that when the water rises, he can float. We're trying to make sure, God, that when the floods come, he can float. Give us wisdom, I pray, today as we dedicate this child. As we give him back to you, oh God.
I want to be
before the rain falls, before the clouds rise, before the storm comes.
You can use.
We're moved by fear as things are yet not seen. We give him back to you, God. I pray for Brother and Sister Harris, God. Anoint him, God. Give him wisdom beyond their years, God.
I want to be a willing vessel.
Vessel.
it for your family.
I want to be a willing vessel, an instrument you choose.
I want to empty
up myself,
Lord, available to you. Yes, I do. Of the Lord all over the house. I want to be a vessel. I want to be a vessel. I want to be a vessel. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Make me and mold me, Jesus. We're going to pray one more time before we go. 2 weeks ago, I was in Southern South Carolina and got done preaching a meeting, Brother Harris, and a pastor friend of ours, our age. This girl was 11, the boy was about 7. In the midst of preaching, consecutive nights, began to feel something in the Holy Ghost, and a couple sleepless nights, and I knew that there was an attack against the family. As we were driving home Friday night, some things had broken in the Holy Ghost at service, and God had given victory. We pulled into the portico of the hotel there, and I watched this father, strong, prime of his life. Brother Harris, I watched his shoulders settle and tears begin to run down his face. And he told me in a few short words that turned into a prayer meeting of, please pray for my family. Doing the work of God, building a church, and said, what do you do when your 7-year-old says, Daddy, there was somebody in the room last night? This may scare some of you, but it's the sincerity of the moment. And voice is telling his son to go and get a knife and do harm. 7 years old. He said, and then to top that off and begin to tell me about his daughter, 11 years old, and the attack of the enemy. I feel like praying one more time for the kids that are born into ministry, that have to fight the devils that their daddies are preaching out of pulpits and out of churches and out of countries. And I feel this in my Holy Ghost. Elder Harris, Sister Harris, you're there. Ministry, I want you to gather around. If your kids are close, you ought to put your hand on them. I want us to pray a hedge of protection before we leave this house. That ain't no devil in hell or out of hell is going to put their hands on our babies. Moms, gather close. Daddies, put your hands on your son. God, I pray for a second hedge upon our kids. The devil only saw one hedge, but Job, Daddy, had built a second hedge. Hallelujah. I rebuke the spirits that try to sneak in the cover of night to get at that daddy and to get at that preacher, that man of God. Oh, Lord, you've anointed Brother Harris to preach the gospel, to be a sounding voice in a lost and dying world. God, I pray you put your biggest angels around them babies. Put big flaming swords. Oh, I wish I had a mama help me pray right now. Put your warrior angels with swords in their hands. Keep those precious little girls. Guard them, oh God. Keep them, my God, by your word and by your blood. Touch his son. Let him raise up, Lord. Do your will and do your work. We pray it all in the matchless name of Jesus. I want to echo what my father has said. Ain't no devil going to get our kids. Come on, somebody. Ain't no devil going to get our kids. Have faith. They're not here, Pastor. Have faith. Have faith. Oh, we need to pray again. I feel it in the Holy Ghost. Ain't no devil gonna get my daughter. Ain't no devil. Come on, pray it. When's the last time you, come on, boldly tell the devil, you're not getting my son. You're not getting my daughter. We're dedicating today, but we're also declaring, except the Lord build the house. Except the Lord build the house. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The church said in Jesus' name, shake hands, love one another. Make sure you greet Brother and Sister Harris. Three generations. My God, what are we going to do now? God bless you. We'll see you here tonight early for prayer. Let's be ready for another distinct move of the Holy Ghost. Greet somebody. Introduce yourself. Make sure you welcome all of our guests and friends. God bless you in the name of Jesus. You are dismissed. Thank you.